From Pakistan, Islamabad. Okay, thank you so much. Good afternoon. So my name is Imrana. I'm from Islamabad. I teach at Quaid-I-Azam University. And this molecular energy level is not my subject. Umberto asked me to cover this, but we will do something. Okay, so it's just an outline, the brief introduction about molecules, what is the difference between atoms and molecule, what are the molecular orbital theory, molecular transitions and interaction of matter with radiation, and types of molecular energy levels. Because in atom, we have only the electronic levels, but in molecules, we have different kinds of energy levels. So usually in nature, we say that there exist 92 different atoms which have stable elements that corresponds to stable atoms. So these atoms can form large entities by using covalent bonding or ionic bonding. So those entities are called molecules. So number of atoms in a molecule can vary from two, like in nitrogen, oxygen, but to many thousand, like in DNA and protein, we will see in the coming days. And molecules form when the total energy of the electron is lower in the molecule than in the individual atom, and this is the reason comes from of above principle. To put electron, that states that to put electron into a lowest energy configuration in atoms. So the same principle goes for molecules, as well as if, like, if you have 1s, it should have 2 electron, then 2s, 2 electron, 2p, 6 electron, that is the principle, and we follow this in molecules too. Okay, properties of molecules depend on the specific kind of atoms they are composed of, how the special structure of molecules, how they are arranged, and the binding energy of atoms or the group of atoms present in a molecule. There are different types of molecules. We say them monoatomic molecules, and sometimes we call it just a monoatomic atom because it is a single atom molecule. And these are the elements that don't have tendency to form molecules. And at the standard temperature and pressure condition, elements which are stable single atom molecules are the noble gases, like helium, neon, argon, krypton, and xenon. At higher temperature, all the elements are in gas form. So diatomic molecules are those molecules which consist of only two atoms of same or different kind, like, for example, hydrogen, oxygen, and carbon monoxide, nitric oxide. They are two atom molecules, and they are called diatomic molecules. And polyatomic molecules are consist of stable system consisting of three or more atoms. So, sorry, it skipped one slide. This is atomic oxygen, monoatomic. We can, it is stable. And then this is diatomic, and polyatomic ozone is a polyatomic form of oxygen. So there are three formulas basically that describe a molecule. Its empirical formula, its molecular formula, and its structural formula. So empirical formula indicates the simplest whole number ratio of all the atoms present in a molecule, while the molecular formula describes the exact number of types and kinds of types of atom in a single molecule of a compound, while the structural formula indicates not only the number of atoms present in molecule, also their spatial arrangement. So this is the glucose molecule, and you can see it is consist of carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen. This is the structural form of this glucose molecule. And here you can see that for our empirical molecule formula of glucose is CH2. It is just the whole number ratio of atoms present in glucose. But if you multiply this with 6, which is a whole number, you get the molecular formula of glucose. So this is again another example of some empirical formulas, molecular formulas, and the structure formula of methane, dinitrogen monoxide, and benzene. So these are the three formulas are needed to explain a molecular structure. So we know that what is an isotope, because isotopes are same atoms which have same number of protons but different numbers of neutrons. So, but it maintain their neutral character, so their physical behavior and their properties remain same. But isomers are two molecules with the same atom joined together in different shape. that means their structure formula are different. So they have same molecular formula but different chemical structure. For example, butane and isobutane. I'll show you their formula on the next slide. Then we have allotrope. They are different structural forms of same element but can exhibit quite different physical and chemical properties, because we know that diamond, graphite, graphene, they are all consist of pure carbon, but due to their structure, their properties are different. So we can see this is the butane, or also it's pentane or isopentane. They have same number of carbon, hydrogen, but their structure is different. So they are called structural isomers. Then there are geometrical isomers, and I think the third, something like that. Okay, and this for carbon, you can see this is the diamond, structure of diamond, and the second is the structure of graphite. So they are all consist of carbon, the pure form of the same element, and the different structure, so they have the different properties. So in spectroscopy, or in the molecular spectroscopy, we study the interaction of electromagnetic radiations with matter. And based on the analysis of electromagnetic radiation absorbed, emitted, we can gather information about the chemical analysis and molecular structure of that material. So what is an energy? The question arises, what is an energy level? For any quantum mechanical system or a particle that is bound in a bound state, bound states mean it is confined spatially, it can only take discrete values of energy, and those discrete value of energies are called energy levels. So this term energy level is commonly used for the energy levels of electron in an atom, ion, or molecule, which are bound by the electric field of nucleus, because nucleus has protons and there is a binding between electron and proton that is also called the Coulomb's potential between these two. And this also, this energy level scheme also refers to the energy levels of nuclei, or the vibrational and rotational energy levels in molecules, because in molecules we also, apart from the electronic transition, we have vibrational and rotational transitions. We will see in a couple of minutes that what are those energy levels. So ground state is when an electron is, or a molecule or ion is at the lowest possible energy. So, and it's, and that electron, that atom, ion, or molecule is called, it is in its ground state, because usually the electron is in the ground state, and we call that atom, ion, or molecule is in its ground state. When an electron have a higher energy than its ground state, we say that it is excited. And then there are some quantum mechanical state that have the same energy, those states are called degenerate. So degenerate energy levels, if they have the same energy. And these are some basic things. And then we have different kinds of chemical bonding between atoms, which are which make those molecules. And one is the covalent bond, which involves the sharing of electron pair between atoms. As atoms approach each other to covalently bond, their orbitals affect each other. And others energy level to form bonding. And anti-bonding. The energy level of bonding orbital is always lower, and the energy level of the anti-bonding orbital is high. And when molecules is in lower bonding state, then it is stable. So the covalent bonding electron occupy the lower energy bonding orbital, which may be signified by, we call it by sigma or pi bonding in this molecular spectroscopy. So it is basically the covalent bonding that is based on the sharing of electrons. So molecular orbital theory evolves from the atomic orbital theory, because as the atoms approach towards each other, they affect the orbits of each other due to this Coulomb attraction and repulsion. So we can say that orbitals of molecule can be specified by this capital phi, and A is a constant, and this small phi represents the atomic orbitals. So molecule have discrete energy level. There is no continuum between their electronic level, vibrational level, or rotational level. So they absorb electromagnetic radiation when the energy of the photon corresponds with a different in energy between two states, whether it's, sorry, yeah. No, you are right, it is not always linear, because sometimes it is for linear molecule. I think. And but if it's a non-linear molecule and it has a group of atoms, usually the problem is if it is the sharing of electron for the covalent bonds, it is basically two electrons are involved between sharing a pair of an electron is involved. Then it is kind of this formula. But for, of course, the molecules have many, many different forms. It is polyatomic, and then they have different groups of atoms evolved, and then it is a complicated thing, okay? So energy can be stored either as a potential energy or the kinetic energy. And there is a translational energy, which is the small amount of energy stored as a kinetic energy of the molecule. Then we have rotational energy. This is the kinetic energy associated with the rotational motion of the molecule. Then we have vibrational energy in case of molecules. That is the oscillatory motion of the atoms, which are or group of atoms present within that molecule. Then we have the electronic energy, which is stored as the potential energy. Energy, because when the electron makes a transition from its ground state or the valence state to some higher state, so we have this electronic energy. So all except translational energy are quantized. So it means the vibrational, rotational, and electronic energy of molecules are quantized, and they represent a quantum mechanical system because, and what is the force? It is the force due to the nucleus present there of all the constituent atoms. Okay, so this is the molecule, atomic and molecular vibration corresponds to excited energy level in quantum mechanics. So if you have, I think it will move. Okay, atom is vibrating at some frequency and it absorbs, it is oscillating between excited and the ground level. So we can say that atom is at least partially in an excited state. Atom is a quantum mechanical system, and we talk only in terms of probability, that there is a probability of finding the atom in excited or ground state. But in the presence of a photon, it is a finite probability that atom is in an excited state, or it can emit a photon and it can come back to the ground state. So for any given frequency, only one value of quantum energy of photon is possible. Transition between energy levels occur by absorption. If there is a photon of frequency equal to the difference between excited and ground level, there is a finite probability that electron will absorb the photon and go in the excited state. And if it is in excited after the lifetime of a molecule is quite in nanoseconds. So we can see that when an atom or molecule is in excited state, it falls to a lower energy level. Eventually it has to. And that is the reason it's quantum mechanically that it is the vacuum fluctuation that are associated with this spontaneous emission phenomena or the zero point energy that caused this transition. So it emits a photon. So atom is in excited state. After some time in atom, we can say it is the atomic lifetime, which is of the order of 10 raised to power minus 8 second. It's not for the metastable state, which can be for 10 raised to power minus 4 second. Or if it's a Rydberg atom, that lifetime can be in the range of seconds. But here in molecules, they remain excited for a few nanoseconds. And upon de-excitation, emit a photon of light. Why about a photon of light? When they emit this visible part of electromagnetic spectrum, it means that they are doing fluorescence, which we will discuss in my tomorrow's presentation. What is fluorescence? What is the difference between phosphorescence? So this process is called fluorescence. So this is the spontaneous emission. Okay, leave it. So atom and more, sorry, yeah. Yeah. It's just a spontaneous emission, a general expression for atom and molecule. I will explain fluorescence tomorrow in my presentation based on only for molecules, the singlet states and triplet states, the behavior of phosphorescence and fluorescence. Today we just want that if atom or molecule or any quantum mechanical system consists of a particle, ion or molecule is in its excited state, it doesn't stay there forever. It eventually drops from the excited state to ground because nature prefers to live in its ground state. So if it is in excited state, atom or molecule, it de-excites and emits a photon. Yeah, I will discuss, because fluorescence is, if in a molecule, with the corresponding to molecule, because tomorrow we have to do this fluorescence, so that's why I mentioned that molecules typically remain excited for nanoseconds, and of course there are some vibrational transitions involved before the fluorescence, and we will go into the detail tomorrow. Okay, so this is stimulated absorption. Absorption is always stimulated. There is no such thing as spontaneous absorption. So you have to, they absorb photon, provided the energy of this photon is equal to the difference of energy between excited and ground state of that quantum mechanical system. That's why I'm saying quantum mechanical system instead of emphasizing on atoms or molecules, right? So a downward transition involves emission of a photon of energy, and it emits the energy difference between these two energy levels. They can be vibrational level in a molecule, they can be rotational level, they can be electronic level in a molecule. But for a quantum system, if it is in excited state, it means that it has higher energy than its ground state. So if the atom is in excited state, or electron of that quantum mechanical system is in excited state, there is a finite probability that if another incident photon is falls on this atom or molecule or ion which is in excited state, there is a finite probability that it will emit another photon of same energy and phase. So this process in 1916, Einstein showed that apart from spontaneous emission and stimulated absorption, there is another process that is called stimulated emission, and this laser is based on the light amplification of stimulated emission of radiation. In order to get to behave a molecular system or an atomic system to be as an behave as an amplifier, we need population inversion. If the number of atoms, molecules, or ion are greater in its excited state as compared to their ground state, then there is a this process is called population inversion. And if there is a single incident photon, so it acts as an avalanche, and we have many photons of in-phase photons which are coherent, and this process is the basis of as I mentioned earlier about the laser. So these are the molecular, the spontaneous emission. It emits a photon, it absorbs a photon, and it starts stimulating. If a photon is incident, you get two photons, in-phase photons. Okay, so what are the electromagnetic radiation? There are different kind of things. We know that higher the frequency, higher. Because you know, there are many different principles. We explain this thing because there is a model in which we say that this electron is in excited state. It is already oscillating. So when it absorbs another frequency, another photon of the same frequency, which is equal to the difference between these two energy levels, it starts oscillating with twice the frequency. But in photon picture, we say that it emits two photons. But if you are talking about in terms of wave picture, then it is the amplitude of the wave that has increased. So you can describe light by using wave picture or by using photon picture. You're welcome. So electromagnetic radiation consists of photons, and the energy of the photon is directly proportional to the frequency. Yeah? I'm sorry, I have to come near to you. Yeah, please. Yeah. You need a lot of energy. No, it depends upon that you want what you want to do, because I will compare, because molecules have different energy levels. It has electronic levels, vibrational level, and rotational level. Minimum energy is required to excite rotationally. And more energy is required as compared to the rotation. You need little more energy to excite it in vibrational levels. And lot of energy is needed to excite electronically. So I'll give you a comparison. Yeah. Any other question? Okay, so energy is directly proportional to frequency. This is the usual concept about the Planck's law, that E is equal to h nu. And in spectroscopy limit, spectroscopy people use wave number, not me. So wave number is actually equal to 1 over lambda. So it's a meter inverse, but the most commonly used are centimeter inverse. Higher the wave number, higher will the energy of that photon. So this is the electromagnetic spectrum, which I think Umberto, no, I am positive Umberto showed that. So this is the radio frequency. Radio frequencies have, you can see that it's of the order of 10 raised to power 3. And its wavelength is of the order of 10 raised to power 3, and frequency in hertz is 10 raised to power. As you go from radio frequency to the gamma rays, frequency increases, as well as the energy of photon increases. If you have an X-ray photon, it will have a lot more energy as compared to microwave or infrared photon. So this is the visible part of electromagnetic spectrum, which we see as color or the world we live in. Okay, so this is a whole range of electromagnetic spectrum. You can have interaction in microwave region, infrared, visible, ultraviolet, X-ray, and gamma. Gamma is usually for nucleus. So if interaction of radiation with matter, there are different categories. Like he asked me the question that you have ultraviolet, you have visible, infrared, or microwave. So if you have a material and levels available corresponding to microwave energy, then there is a finite probability that molecule will get excited and go to the next rotational level under this microwave. And if it is in infrared region and you have available energy levels, and this proton corresponds to infrared, will be get absorbed by that vibrational level of molecule and get excited and go to the next vibrational level. If it is visible and ultraviolet region, then it will the electronic transition will take place. So you can see, like I told you, that less energy it is in the microwave region, less frequency, so amount of energy is less. Next is the vibrational, next is the electronic level. So, but if you have X-rays, there are two processes that can happen. One is that is called the photoionization, that quantum energy of X-ray photons are too high to be absorbed by electronic transition in most atoms. So they ionize the atom, and this process is called photoionization. And the second process that can take place with this X-ray interaction is the Compton scattering. In this process, part of the energy is given to an electron, and it goes to a higher state, and the rest of energy is given to a longer wavelength X-ray. Longer wavelength means it has less energy as compared to the incident energy. So, and the rest is to a lower energy photon. Compton spectring, X-ray will incident on atoms. Some energy will be used to ionize or photoionize the electron, and the rest of the energy can go as a longer wavelength electron. Yeah.
So, is there a different condition to occur?
Yes, because if it is just the ionization energy, then it will take place, the photoionization. If it is a Compton scattering, then electron get
Compton.
Yeah. Okay, so ultraviolet interaction, if I go back to this picture, you see that first is the photoionization or the Compton effect. If there are no energy level, I forgot to mention, then the medium will behave as a transparent to those radiation. If there is no possibility of having a microwave transition or rotational transition or vibrational transition or electron, so material will be transparent to those radiation. So first is the X-ray, which are high energies, and they can do photoionization and Compton scattering. Then we have this ultraviolet part of this electromagnetic spectrum, and what they do. The radiation is absorbed strongly with the surface of skin by electron. Okay, this is a part of this medical physics that you know that they are absorbed by the electrons, and they get excited. Ultraviolet is a process which is in the region of when electron moves from electron, it is in the region of electronic transitions. If you have ultraviolet or visible light photon, so the transition which can happen is, if possible, is the electronic transition. So what happens that electron can get excited from its ground level to higher level in ultraviolet, and also in the visible range. So if we go here, we can see that near UV radiation, which is at the boundary of visible part, is absorbed very strongly in the surface layer of skin. If you are talking about the molecules present in our skin, we get sunburns, we get skin cancer if ionization process takes place. If it's just excited, layer of the electron. At higher energies, ionization limit for many molecules are reached, and the more dangerous photoionization takes place. So it burns your skin. UV always burns your skin. And if ionization produced, if it's just only the excitation of the electron, then it's sunburn. If unfortunately it's ionization, then there is a risk of skin cancer. So I personally suffered these conditions, so I added this slide. I know I have a problem of this acute photosensitivity with the UVs. And so then we have visible interaction. It again corresponds to the electronic transitions. So is always absorbed by electronic transition. Higher energies are absorbed more relative to the low energies. So if we compare the visible part of electromagnetic spectrum, we know that the wavelength of red light is longer. And wavelength of blue light or frequency of blue light is higher. So blue is higher energy as compared to red. So higher energy means that red light is less strongly absorbed than blue light. But we are all standing in this visible light. We don't get burn. We feel a bit heat, but we don't get burns. UV light can burn your skin. It can damage very badly. So absorption of visible light cause heating, but no ionization. So car windshields transmit visible light, but absorb higher. They make the windshield in such a manner that you can get some heat from the visible part of that spectrum, but you can be protected from UV lights. Because, okay, so these are the infrared interactions. The energy levels of infrared light corresponds to the energy required to cause molecular vibration. The vibrations arises as molecular bonds are not rigid, but they behave like, because there is a kind of dipole moment between two, due to a covalent bonding between a molecule, atoms of a molecule. So they stretch and they bend. So there are two kinds of motions are involved, and these bonds are not rigid. It's not that electron, one atom is here and another, and there is a rigid part in between. So they are spring-like. They can bend, they can stretch, as molecular bands are not rigid but behave like springs. So this is a symmetric stretch. You can see that the both are going in this direction. This is asymmetric, and this is, they are bending, then there is a scissoring and different names for these. And this happened in the infrared region, and it corresponds to the molecular vibrational transitions in a molecule. So vibrational transition are subdivided into two classes, stretching, symmetric and asymmetric. So we see this is a symmetric stretch, this is asymmetric stretch. If the both molecules on this sides are moving with the same strength, then it is a symmetric stretch. So then there is a bending, which is divided into many things. It is wiggling, twisting. So stretching frequencies are always higher when you are then corresponding bending frequency. But it is, you need less energy to bend something in as compared to stretch something. So are higher than corresponding bending frequency. It is easier to bend a bond than to stretch or compress it. Bonds to hydrogen have higher stretching frequency than those to heavier atom. Triple bonds have higher stretching frequency than corresponding double bonds, which in turn have higher frequency as compared to the single bonds. So microwave interaction take place in the region of rotational transitions of a molecule. So quantum energy of molecular photon, microwave photon is of the order of 10 raised to power minus 5 to minus 3 electron volt, matches the range of energies separating quantum states of molecular rotation. So like electronic and vibrational transition, rotational motion of molecule is also quantized. It's a quantum mechanical system. So absorption of microwave radiation causes heating due to increased molecular rotational activity. So if the rotational is increased, we all see this thing happening in our life daily because we all use microwave ovens at our home. So the food we want to heat contains water. So when the microwave, high-intensity microwaves are produced, they start this rotational motion. And in this way, the food gets warmed or cooked. So they use high-intensity microwaves to heat materials. So there are, it is only possible when there, this molecular rotation is present and this kind of transition. Yeah. No, vibrational also created this kind of sunburns and these kind of things, vibrational ultraviolet interactions. They also creating heating. Yeah, because if you see the electron, the higher energy ionization, many molecules are a more dangerous photoionization occurs. Sunburn is basically when happens when it get burns and vibrational, yeah. So rotational also, but it is in the microwave region, and we know that microwave energy, microwaves are not high energy waves. So it, but their process, how they transmit the energy they gain from that microwaves is by the rotational, by increasing the rotational motion of the food you are cooking or you food you want to heat. So it only, microwaves are absorbed by the rotational levels of molecule, whether it's a part of our skin, or whether it's a part of a food, or whether it's a part of a drink, the coffee mug or anything you put in, it's only the microwave will be absorbed if, because they are quantum systems. The absorption will only take place if there are two levels in between that microwave can be, make transition from the lower rotational level to higher rotational level, okay? So these are the, this is just a schematic that we have, these blue lines shows the ground state, electronic state, then this blue is the first excited state. Then these green ones are vibrational energy levels, so basically an electronic state hosts a number of vibrational levels. Then on each vibrational level, there is a set of rotational levels. So this is how, after studying the spectrum of many molecular compounds, they assemble this data that radiation can be absorbed or emitted if the molecule changes any of its energy state. So if you have an object, if you are not precise, you know that there is a possibility you can excite this molecular object in vibrational level. So you will provide the same energy if it is infrared, it's UV, or it is in the visible part. And if you know that your source is producing visible light, and you will get electronic transition. If there are other kinds of frequencies involved that can be this infrared, it can be microwave, then there is a finite probability you will get some excitations in rotational level and some excitations in the vibrational level of molecule. So these are the rotational levels. These, the first from the ground state of rotational level to excite is called the fundamental mode. Similarly, in vibrational, that is the fundamental mode. In electronic transition, this is the ground state, and this is the first excited state. I think I have a better, like you said, that you need, it is the wave number. It is given in the wave number. The rotational transition is less than vibrational. The energy required to do this rotational transition is less than the energy required to do vibrational transition, and that is less than to energy required to do, sorry? Why? Because there is a lot of separation between electronic levels. Yeah, so you need a lot of, because E2 minus E1 is too high as compared to the vibrational and rotational levels. Okay, So these are the molecular energy level, again, the vibrational transition. So the same thing, the number on this figure. And absorption spectrum of a molecule is that the molecule is determined by all allowed transition. Of course, if you want to see, like I was telling you, that if you shine a molecular object with the, if you do it with a known kind of radiation, you know that you are using visible part of electromagnetic spectrum or infrared or ultraviolet or microwave region. So you know that what kind of result you expect, which frequencies will be absorbed and which will remain. So you can measure your spectrum, absorption spectrum and emission spectrum, and then you can calculate the data. So if it's... So this is actually the electronic, the ground state. This is the first excited state. Energy increases in this direction. So these are the vibrational level. We represent them with the number nu or v. And the rotation is represented by this j, angular momentum. So this is the vibrational quantum number. This is the rotational quantum number. So if you see, molecular motion is governed by quantum mechanics. Molecules like atom, like electrons, are quantum mechanical system. Apart from their translation motion of those molecules, all other energies are quantized, whether it is an electronic energy, vibrational energy, or rotational energy. So it is a quantum mechanical system. So chemical bonds like covalent bond can act like a spring and can display simple harmonic motion, like I showed you in a cartoon. So they do stretching, bending. So these are like spring. They are quantized. These vibrations are quantized too. Because, and these are quantized like harmonic oscillator. So, and you all know that a harmonic oscillator is the simplest quantum mechanical system with an energy that is equal to h cut omega with n plus half. And that half h cut omega energy is zero point energy, which is present in each mode. Similarly, in each mode of this vibrational motion, there is a zero point energy. So, okay, let's go here. So so energy due to vibrations are quantized. So h cut omega, v is the vibrational quantum number. For harmonic oscillator, you put here the number state or n, which is the number of photons. So vibrational quantum number is from 0, 1, 2, 3. Its angular frequency is the spring constant and the effective mass of the atoms involved. If it is a diatomic atom, you will have m1 plus m2 divided by this thing. So an effective spring constant K for bond involved, and effective mass, I explained. So half h cut omega comes from the quantum mechanics and represents zero point energy. Do you know about zero point energy? What is a zero point energy? You know about vacuum fluctuations? So what are the vacuum fluctuations? Okay, but he gave a right answer, and what he is saying is when we quantized the electromagnetic field, usually we all study the classical description of electromagnetic field, which is given by the Maxwell's equation. When we quantize, there are certain things which are not explained in the classical picture of electromagnetic radiations. So we need to quantize. We quantized electromagnetic field on the basis of harmonic oscillator. We associate each mode of an harmonic oscillator with one frequency of an electromagnetic field. So when you quantize, you see that ground state energy is not equal to zero. We know, we live in classical world, we know that if there is a vacuum, the energy of the vacuum is equal to zero. Classically, vacuum is described as something which has no energy. But quantum mechanically, vacuum is not empty. Each, there is a half cut half H-cut omega. Omega corresponds to, it can be microwave, it can be visible, infrared, ultraviolet, gamma. So half H-cut omega energy is always present in quantum mechanical vacuum. And it is, and if we take into account that zero point energy, many theories become correct. And the things which were not explained using this classical theory of electromagnetic radiation, for example, the spontaneous emission. We used to say, okay, the atomic lifetime is 10 raised to power minus 8. After that, it decays spontaneously. No. These are the vacuum fluctuation which cause that push that atom in excited state to make a downward transition. So these vacuum fluctuations are responsible for many phenomena which we can observe experimentally, but according to the Dirac theory, we were not able to explain them. So half H-cut omega is a lot of energy, and that is called the zero point energy, and that we get from the quantization of electromagnetic wave. So it cannot be harvested or extracted. Its energy is there. This half H-cut omega is always present there. Still exists at absolute zero. It is even at the zero temperature. All molecules are in, even if all the molecules are in V is equal to zero state, but this energy is present. Yeah, please. Yeah, sure.
For the energy, for the zero point energy, we have the Hamiltonian of the system.
Yeah.
In quantum physics, we have the energy corresponding to the system is Ashraf omega times n plus.
That's half. Yeah.
So in for the vacuums, in the vacuum
space, you see, n is equal to zero. Is equal to this half, right? But that's the way to how to calculate the energy. But the main thing is that you start with the, actually the you start with the energy of an harmonic oscillator, its kinetic energy plus its potential energy. Then you quantized your electric field on magnetic field. In quantization, this electric field is also an operator, which is given by A plus A dagger, something, if it is a kind of thing, it is the spatial function. Similarly, B is also a operator. So what you were saying is the quantized and Hamiltonian is equal to H cut omega n plus half. And even if n is equal to 0, n represents the Fock state or the number state. Even if we are in vacuum, so then vacuum state is represented like this. We still have ground state energy that will be equal to half H cut omega. Yeah, so this is a lot of energy corresponding to each frequency. OK, so this energy level, and we all know the energy levels of harmonic oscillator are separated by omega. Sorry? Yeah, yeah. Because look, there are, if I give you an example, there is a lamp shift. If you are from spectroscopy, everybody knows about lamp shift. This is the energy difference between 2s half and 2p half. According to Dirac theory, if we calculate, experimentally observed shift is 1057 megahertz, right? Umberto, it's near to between the energy difference between 2s half and 2p half of hydrogen atom is, and it is observed.
And we don't have the vacuum.
No, no, but it's not, the vacuum energy is there. It's, you are not going to measure it, you are not going to extract it, it's there. Because in actual sense, your vacuum is not empty. In actual description of vacuum, you don't have to, if you are created a very class grade one vacuum room or clean room, still your vacuum is not empty. It has energy. It is there, but there are certain quantities we can calculate by using classical theory of electromagnetism. And it agrees with experimentally observation. So, but like, for example, I give you a spectroscopic example, the 2s half and 2p half, if you calculate in theory, so you will get that they have same energy. But experimentally, if you measure the energy difference between 2s half and 2p half, it is 1057 megahertz frequency difference. And that agrees with the quantum theory. If you take into account the zero point energy, then your theory matches the experiment. Why we need quantum mechanics if classical mechanics was enough? Because there are certain things we cannot explain using the classical mechanics. So we need, but we didn't discarded classical mechanics as we started using. Of course, you cannot describe the motion of a car or a bus or aeroplane by using quantum mechanics. You need classical mechanics. So there are different regimes. So vacuum, classical, it's empty. Quantum mechanically, it's not empty. In reality, it's not empty. It has energy. So that energy caused many things. Are you satisfied a bit? Okay. So this is so diatomic molecule, this is the effective mass. As I mentioned, you can multiply and divide with the sum. So energy scale for molecular vibration is much less than that for electronic transitions. Excitation energies correspond to the IR region of the electron. Maybe these are about vibrational transition in a molecule. So vibration levels are built on electronic state. Each electronic state will host the whole range of vibrational levels. So this is a kind of a picture. You can see that this is a fundamental IR transition, which is between 0 to 1. These are all the vibrational level. This first one is the electron, n is equal to 1. N is the principal quantum number. N is equal to 2 is the principal quantum number. It is the first excited state. And these are the fundamental IR transition. So you can make transitions from here to here by visible radiations. You can make transitions by using IR radiation between these vibrational levels, because they are separated by an energy range which corresponds to the IR spectrum of electromagnetic radiation. If you need to excite between vibrational levels, you have to use IR radiation. If you need to excite between electronic levels, you need visible or ultraviolet. Okay, so this is again the repetition of molecular levels. You can see these are the diatomic, which can be N2, oxygen, or CO. So it is a symmetric, this thing. These are the linear atomic molecules. CO2 is a linear molecule. This is a symmetric stretch that they move in opposite direction. This is bending. They are bending like this. And this is an asymmetric stretch that this moves toward this, this moves away, and this, the center one moves this thing. So there can be many possibilities in a molecule. There are many complicated, we will see in DNA structure and RNA structure that those molecules are quite complicated. They don't follow these simple kind of vibrational modes. Okay, now the rotational level, rotational energy of a molecule is again quantized. So it is, its energy is given by this, which is J is the angular momentum given like this. So this is the moment of inertia. So it is rotating with this thing. So you know how the angular momentum is related with moment of inertia and the angular velocity. Those all formula came from that moment. Hence, rotational parameter can be different for each rotation axis. So this is also quantized. This is a quantum number which is given here. So this is an integral number. So these energies which corresponds to the rotation of a molecular transition is also quantized. So excitation energy corresponds to the microwave region. We saw before that if we shine a molecular molecule with microwave energy, then what will happen if there is a possibility of transition between rotational level, then it will take place. Energy scale for rotation is much less than vibrational, and for vibrational, it is much less than electronic transition. Each vibrational level has rotational bands built on it, and selection rule is plus minus one. Okay, these are the rotational levels. So if you compare this picture with the previous of this kind, you can see that here, this is visible radiation, which means the transition can take place between one electronic state to another electronic state. Yeah. No, no, pi and sigma are two kinds of bonding, covalent bonding. One is called pi. So this is, I took it from some website. So this is for sigma also. And it can be pi NT orbital. If it is NT orbital, then it can be steric on pi and sigma. There are different kinds of bondings. So this is a visible radiation, and here you can see between these consecutive vibrational mode, you need IR radiation. If you go to this cartoon, so you can see these are IR radiation. Now, these are vibrational levels. This side, you have vibrational levels, and in order to go from one vibrational level to another vibrational level, the part of electromagnetic spectrum you need is in IR region. And for a rotational, you need microwave radiations. So if you want to go from 0 to 1, which is the fundamental of vibrational mode, you need to shine this molecule with the microwave. And yeah. Sorry?
Energy formula for electronic transition.
And, yeah. More or less, yeah. That is for vibration, not the electronic. Yeah, and for this one, it depends on, you can see that it depends on H cut. It is also quantized. It depends on this J and J plus 1. And it is also quantized. This is the moment of inertia, because we know that if there is a kind of router or something, or a kind of gyroscope, you know what is its moment of inertia and what is the angular velocity, and you relate these things with this. So in case of rotational motion, the molecules is also doing the same kind of thing, like a gyroscope doer. So this energy is also quantized. But this energy lies in the range of microwave part of electromagnetic spectrum. For vibrational, it lies in IR region. For electronic, it lies in ultraviolet and visible part. For photoionization, it lies in X-rays. So there are different parts of electromagnetic spectrum, and each does a different kind of transition. So this is, they are divided into P, Q, and R branches depending upon the selection rule. If delta J is equal to minus 1, that means that if it goes from this rotational level of higher J value to lower J value, because selection rule delta J is equal to plus minus 1 is allowed. Okay, so, and delta J equals to 0 means there is, this is not a rotational motion, it is only the vibrational transition, because if delta J is equal to 0, that means you are going from J is equal to 1 to J is equal to 1, or J is equal to 2 to J is equal to 2, and actually you are changing from one vibrational level to other. So this branch corresponds to pure vibration. And this is when the J value is less. So you can see here that this is the vibration. It is only possible if you go from 1 to 1 that you are changing vibrational levels. Otherwise, from here you go from plus and minus. So these are called P branches. If delta J is moving from J is equal to 2 of this vibrational level to J is equal to 1, you will get minus 1. So if it is going from J is equal to 2 to J is equal to 3 in this range, then you get plus 1. So delta J plus minus 1 is the selection rule, and delta J equals to 0 to corresponds to the vibrational transitions. Okay, in molecule, we have two opposing forces. The repelling force of nuclei when there are atoms, and their nucleus repel each other. And the binding force of the electrons towards the nucleus. If the orbit of electrons change, then the binding force will change. The net potential energy of the, that is the net potential energy of the, if you excite an electron from this level to this level, of course now the potential energy is changed. Okay? You know, what is the Coulomb's potential between nucleus? And if we consider the example of hydrogen atom, which consists of a single proton and an electron, orbiting around that nucleus. So what is the scale of energy between electron and proton in a hydrogen atom? Inverse square law, it obeys the. So this means the inner atomic distance will change. Different electronic level will have different rotational and vibrational constants. So if you draw all these kind of, so taking rotation, vibration, excitation, you need these all energies you have to add, rotational, vibrational, and electronic, and everything is quantized. So complex molecule may have many vibrations, like you asked before. So there, it's easy to say in theory, but in reality, these molecules are quite complicated. So may have many vibrational modes, rotational modes. The combination of these different modes lead to the smearing of discrete spectrum. So the broad bumps appear rather than discrete lines. It is hard to distinguish between the lines because there is an overlapping. And I think it's the next cartoon. It is a kind of, this is a simple or a linear symmetric molecule, and this is for a complex molecule. You can see if E is the electronic transition, so this is E1 or E2, or you can say this is corresponds to N is equal to 1 level, this corresponds to N is equal to 2 level. So these blue ones are vibrational modes of this level, and these red ones are rotational level of these that host on this vibrational level. So the sum of energy for a simple or symmetric molecule can be a discrete sum of these discrete bands, which you can distinguish that it is the sum of this, it is the sum of all these kind of. But for asymmetric or complex molecules, these energies are different. These vibrational energies can be different. So if you take, you can see that here we have very narrow spacing here. There is a very narrow spacing between these two. So then you can get a different there. You can find a broad band instead of discrete lines. So it, there is a molecular spectrum can change for a simple molecule to a complex molecule. OK, so ignoring electronic, the total energy of the molecule, yeah. Your black line is electronically, N is equal to 4. We will go into the fluorescence tomorrow. But these are two electronic levels. That can be the ground level, and N is equal to 1 or N is equal to 2 level with the principal quantum number. If electron is making transition between these two electronic levels, it needs this much energy to be absorbed so that electron can make transition from here to here. These are very symmetric vibrational level in case every level has H cut omega spacing. They are because there is nothing to, this is a kind of simple molecule. And then there is a very symmetric vibrational level host on, rotational level on this vibration. So if you see the spectrum, absorption spectrum or the emission spectrum of a simple molecule, you can get a symmetric pattern. It absorbs symmetrically, it emits symmetrically because there are in the presence of an, so you will, okay. So, but if you have a complex molecule, because these kind of bondings between, covalent bonding between a complex molecule, ionic bonding between a, so they will affect these, if a molecule is consist of group of atoms, so they affect the molecular orbits in different manner. So now this E1 and 2, they are different, they are, their spacing is different, they are not symmetric like this one. So when you get a spectrum, so you can identify this as a complex molecule. They affect their electronic, vibrational, and rotational level. I hope that I satisfied you.
Sir. We found in experiment that when we, I mean, when we observe the spectra, how we
look. You know, I'm not an experimentalist, but I know that if you shine object or element, you know what kind of frequencies. Now there are books available that this line corresponds to this emission or absorption. This you can compare.
You don't know the molecule
and yeah.
Mm-hmm. You just find by experiment.
Okay.
You light and broad spectrum on molecule and record the.
Okay. So, in a simple way. Yeah, okay. I think that we, I know that this is water. I have, this is a pure water, according to me. Or this is, somebody told me, oh, this is mineral pure water. I know it's emission and absorption spectrum that we have. Of course, it's not the beginning of the world that I don't know the spectrum or absorption or emission of this water. And I know what is present in the water. So if I see, I can compare a new object, a new material or compound, I take a emission and absorption spectrum of that new compound or something, there must be, I have some idea about it contains nitrogen, it contains hydrogen, it contains this or that. Because there are, I think there are signature lines of each. Yeah, so you can compare and you have an idea. Then the different thing, I'm sorry, let me. So I think according to, I'm not very good in this thing, but according to me that due to rotational and vibrational level in a compound, a symmetric and asymmetric stretch can change few things. So I know that is a kind of signature. So, you know, okay, something you mixed in it.
You see two lines near each other.
Okay.
And I don't know which one is vibrational.
Yeah.
Which one is rotational.
Mm-hmm. Okay, how, I will refer to Umberto because he is a spectroscopist. So tell me how you differentiate between two lines, whether it is rotational, because first is the energy, corresponding energy. If that line lies in visible region of its range of frequency or it is absorbed in the visible part of electromagnetic spectrum, I know that it will be electronic transition. If it is in the microwave region, of that, because I know the frequency of microwave region, its limits, its boundary. If line lies there, it means it was a micro. Yeah, okay, if there is no sharp border, yeah, please.
In experiments, I guess with respect to total energy level, I guess he means that how can the understand that which one is related to rotation, which one related to.
But I think, according to me, which I understand is, it should be, if there is only the rotational transition, it should lie in the microwave region of that electromagnetic part. So you know that this emission line, or this the part which is absorbed by this electromagnetic spectrum, which is missing is in microwave region. And of course, for complicated, when there will be a microwave absorption, there will be infrared absorption, there will be, but I'm sure in this period we live in, there are many data, because I saw in my university, yeah, because I know my professor, he used to compare everything. Okay, these lines are this, these lines are this.
Yeah.
Now there are very
different database, and this is because water has one line here, and also by the direction, of the intensity of the line.
Yeah.
You have two lines in water and two lines in hydrogen at the same position, but the difference in intensity, the ratio.
Yeah, because this data, I never worked in a spectroscopy lab, but I saw one of my friend has a spectroscopy.
No,
they have so big, huge books all the time. They measure something and then they are comparing with that. And then they also, I saw that they fit it. Okay, this is the curve fitting, this is this line, to a good approximation. This is how I think things evolve, and it is now, okay, so these are vibrational and rotational. So the wave number, spectrum length, is given by the term value of the two states. You can calculate the spectrum line by the difference of the term value of the two states. You can calculate that. A change in vibrational quantum number V is accompanied by a change in rotational number according to the selection rule, this thing. Because if zero, as I mentioned earlier, if the delta J is equal to zero, it is a change in vibrational level. Okay. So the complete set of rotational transition between two is known as a band, and these are, we have Q branch, R branch, and the P branch, as I showed you before. Yeah, where is that? Okay. These are the, it is the change of vibrational level, but R branch and P branch is for delta J minus 1, and R branch is for delta J plus 1. Okay. So what else? Okay. I'm done. So we will, yeah, please. We will do fluorescence tomorrow.
Questions?
Yeah. Questions, comments? Yeah, please.
In case of